people have speculated about sites under the Great Lakes for 100 years. But it was always assumed they wouldn't preserve, they'd be lost, or they'd be deeply buried. What we've actually proven is that none of that is true. The Alpena-Amberley Ridge is a geological formation that runs obliquely across the Lake Huron Basin. The area became dry land probably around 11,500 years ago, and it stayed above water till about 8,000 years ago. After that, the water levels rose again, and this portion of the lake was never again exposed. We believe that it preserved a kind of ice age-like environment that was attractive to animals like caribou. That attracted our interest as a potential site for early human occupation. They're absolutely Native Americans. The question, though, is who they're directly related to. And that's a question we just really can't answer.
I started work on the AAR when I was in graduate school. I now am a faculty member and I'm a professor, but I've been working on the project that whole time. This project really helped launch my career. It was this new field where there's so few people working in it, and we have a really challenging setting with that far offshore and really deep and cold water. We always say it's kind of like this Pompeii-esque situation because everything is just right where it was in the past. It hasn't been moved around, it hasn't been built on top of, it hasn't been constructed over.
We did the first surveys in 2008. We began looking at specific locations that would have been appealing to hunters. That's also the point that some of these first hunting structures, which are made of stone, became visible. We began investigating first using remote-operated vehicles, which give us video feed, and then we put divers on them.
In the Great Lakes, it's the oldest thing that's ever been found. And in a lot of other parts of the world, these are some of the oldest hunting structures that have ever been found, either on land or underwater.
We began collecting samples, looking for both environmental information, but also artifacts, which we began to find. Many of the kind of tools we find, including these very small microlithic tools, they're completely unknown in the Great Lakes region. We don't find them on land. This time period, you would find very large bifacial spear points and very large flake tools. And we find neither under Lake Huron. This is one of the big problems that we still have unanswered. And that is, did these people simply not use these big tools? Did they have them but not use them when they're out here? Or perhaps were these larger bifaces used in these earliest phases, which we can't see because they're in really deep water or buried?
What's underwater that you can't get on land is organic preservation. It's cold and it's fresh water. You don't have a lot of the organisms or the chemicals, right, that would break down things like wood or bone or plant remains. It's just perfectly preserved.
Peat bogs were an interesting problem. What we found was a huge bed, was almost a kilometer long, of preserved peat. And this peat dated to about 9,500 years ago. It has preserved pine needles, it has preserved seeds, it has preserved leaves. And it's an amazingly rich source of potentially environmental DNA as well. The DNA results will be absolutely transformative. Most of what we know about animals and seasonality, honestly, in archaeology is based on animal bones. And in the entire northeastern U.S., there's almost no bone preserved from this time period because of the very acid forest soils. So if we're able to start extracting ancient DNA, ancient environmental DNA from peat and from these other sources, it will literally be the first time we have positive evidence of what animals were there.
We wanted to show that you could do archaeology in the Great Lakes at this depth and find things that were this age. It's an interesting time right now for the work because the major funding has ended. We've also, in the last year or so, got a lot of kind of new researchers that are really interested in the project, new people that we're collaborating with, and students and Indigenous peoples. So I think it's really critical it continue. It's just finding that source of funding and support to keep it going.
We went from the low-hanging fruit, honestly, which was the big stone hunting structures and predictable locations, to increasingly more subtle aspects of the environment. The way science is funded in the U.S., it's not geared to supporting sustained research. There's nothing that we do that someone else couldn't replicate. but I think it's very unlikely anybody would. Probably when we stop, the work is going to stop.